Give me understanding according to thy word.
Yeah.
Let my supplication come before thee. Deliver me according to thy word. My lips shall utter praise when thou hast taught me thy statutes. My tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. Let thine hand help me, for I have chosen thy precepts. I have longed for thy salvation, O Lord, and thy law is my delight. Let my soul live, and it shall praise thee. And let thy judges help me. And let thy judgments help me. I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek thy servant, for I do not forget thy commandments.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you tonight for your word. Lord, and we cannot thank you enough for the surety that we have contained in the scriptures, written for us, that we might know you, that we might have eternal life, and that we might believe that record that you have given to us of your Son. For we know that in Jesus is life, and without him there is no life. Lord, we thank you for giving us your Son, that we might have life everlasting. Lord, we just pray that you would open our minds and hearts tonight to give to us the manna from above, that we might be strong in our inner man. Lord, that we might be equipped to be able to fight that good fight of faith. For we know it is not a physical fight, but a spiritual battle that we face. And Lord, how we need your strength. Lord, humble us and keep us under the shadow of your wing, Lord, and forgive us where we fail you. In Jesus' name, amen. And starting at verse 169, he says, let my cry come near before thee. Let my cry, my supplication. In verse 170, he says, let my supplication come before thee. Let my cry, let my supplication. Lord, hear me. And give me understanding according to thy word.
Yeah.
Deliver me according to thy word. Our cry comes before the Lord, and he delivers us according to thy word. All brought to us by his grace. Amen.
Amen.
By his grace, we are able to come and ask for more grace. Amen. Because of the grace that has been shed abundantly upon us through Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And it is that same grace that has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. And how else can we come before God but by claiming his grace?
Yeah.
Amen. By thanking him for his grace. And it is because of his grace that our cry can come before him. Amen?
Amen.
Look at Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. In verses 14 through 16 it says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. You see, the reason we are able to come boldly unto the throne of grace is because of our high priest that has gone into the heavens for us, who, the Bible says, makes intercession for us. Amen? Praying for us, not leaving us or forsaking us, but being there with us in whatever we go through, so that we might have that grace in the time of need.
Yeah.
So that we can come boldly to the throne. You know, if we neglect to go to God with our cares, if we neglect to take our problems to Him, if we neglect to come before His throne and ask for help, then we are only hurting ourselves. Amen? We're only asking for the evil that is around us to overtake us. If we do not accept the help that is given to us. Now, a lot of people can't accept help.
Right.
There's a lot of people who don't want help. But you know what? The thing that we need to understand is that we all need help. Amen?
Amen.
There's not one of us that don't need help. And the more that we need, the more that we accept that we need help and start asking for God to help us, the more that we're going to find that He will help us.
Amen.
The Bible says to flee, to resist the devil, and he will flee. Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to us.
Amen.
Amen. If we'll just draw nigh to God and ask Him for His help, He will help. Amen.
Amen.
Because of Jesus Christ, who paid for our sins. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Second Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9 says, "And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me."
Amen.
You see, not being one who won't admit when they need help, being proud or too proud to come before God, or too reliant on other things to come before God, but being that person who glories in that infirmity or whatever it is that is causing us trouble, that it is that which humbles us to come to the throne of God and receive that grace that is sufficient for our needs. It is that grace that is sufficient for whatever need that we have. Amen? For whatever problem that we face, it is the grace of God that will fill that need. Amen?
Amen.
That will heal that wound. That will heal that broken heart. That will create in us that desire to continue on in the faith, holding fast our profession. Therefore, he said, "Most gladly, therefore, I will rather glory in my infirmities."
Yeah.
Because it was his infirmity that brought him before the throne of grace to receive mercy and grace in the time of his need. You see, it's those things in our lives which bring us down to our knees, which we will look back on as precious moments. Because the precious moments in our lives is the ones that drew us closer to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And those are the things, and those are the times in our lives that we need to cherish. Because we need Him, amen?
Amen.
We need Him more than we need breath. We need Him more than we need food. We need Him more than we need water. We need Him more than we need anything in this life.
Yeah.
Look at 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verses 17 and 18. He says, "Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Amen."
Yeah.
You might as well just face it. As long as you are here on this earth, you are going to be a needy person. Amen?
Yes.
You might as well just accept it. Amen? Accept that you're not going to be able to do anything on your own. That you need Him. And knowing these things, knowing that He is our great shepherd of the sheep, amen, knowing that He is here to lead us and guide us and provide for us and to give us the things in our lives that we so desperately need, we need to understand that the things that are around us in this world are only going to draw us away from those things if we do not keep ourselves humble before God.
Yeah.
And that's what he says. Seeing you know these things before, know what? That you need Jesus. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 11 and 12, it says, "Now all these things happened unto them for ensamples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it." What is God saying here? Is he said, these things happen and were written for our admonition. These things happen unto them, unto who? The people of the Bible. The things that happened to them were for our examples. In other words, examples. So that when we are faced with things, we can go to his word and find help in the time of our need.
Yeah.
Because he did not leave us alone to face the temptations alone. But he is faithful. Amen. Yeah. He's given us the answer. He's given us the way of escape. If we'll seek it. Amen. If we will look for it. If we will desire him enough. That pleasing him is first before pleasing our own selves.
Yeah.
Because that's what's wrong with people today.
Yep.
Is they love to please themselves rather than to please God. Look at 1 John chapter 5. And I'm not talking about the lost world. I'm talking about Christians.
Yep.
1 John chapter 5. The lost world, they don't even know where to begin to please God. And that's not even in their interest, you know. But for us, we should want to please God. Amen.
Yeah.
Because of what he has done for us. In 1 John chapter 5 and verses 12 and 14, it says, "He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you." Aren't you glad that he has written unto
mm-hmm.
you?
Amen.
He has written unto you. He has written unto you. He has written unto you. You. This is personal to each one of us tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. This is not just some community thing. It is a personal thing. Amen. God wants to be a personal God. And he is a personal God. Just as the song Marina and the girls sing that, man, he's got all these children, but yet I feel like I'm his only one. Because his relationship with me is personal.
Yeah.
"These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us." Amen. That's the confidence that we have. Why? Because we have a personal Savior. And that personal relationship that we have each day, the experience that we get from taking our cares and casting upon the Lord, that experience that we get from getting into His Word each day and finding what He has for us personally. Not what he has for someone else, but what God has for us personally.
Yeah.
And when we see the care that God has for us personally, then we have the confidence to know that when we come to him, he's going to hear us.
Amen.
Amen. And that when we ask according to his will, he's going to answer. Amen.
Yeah.
According to his will. Isn't that wonderful? What a God we serve. Amen?
Amen.
What a God we serve. And how much love has been bestowed upon us. Do not neglect, amen, as Timothy as Paul told Timothy, do not neglect the gift that has been given to you. Amen? Don't neglect that gift that God Himself placed in you. Because that is a wonderful gift. And if you neglect it, you only have yourself to blame. Boy, I used to hate hearing that growing up. You know, my daddy. You only have yourself to blame. But there are no buts, son. You see, I was taught consequences for my own actions. Mm-hmm. Kids aren't taught that today. Mm-hmm. They're not taught consequences. And I know I'm getting off on a rabbit trail, but that's okay. I'm fixing to catch this sucker. We're going to have him for dinner.
Amen.
When I got in trouble at school, I knew I was going to get trouble at home.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad did not have to go to the school and talk to the teacher.
Nope.
If the principal called and said, your son got a spanking today, I got a spanking when I got home, no questions asked. Because there was consequences for actions.
Mm-hmm.
And kids today, the parent, they get in trouble and the parents go gripe the teachers out instead of disciplining their kids.
Yeah.
And we wonder why we're in the mess we're in today. Because people aren't taught, you know what? God said in His Word, God is not mocked, for whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Yeah, you have the right to make your own choices, but you also have to face the consequences for those things.
Mm-hmm.
And let me tell you, God has given us the tools and the knowledge and the wisdom and everything that pertains to life and godliness right here.
Amen.
If we'll just look for it. Be like that man who found that treasure in a field and went and sold everything he had and bought that field. Amen?
Yeah.
This is the field right here. And if you will give up everything else and put it in right here, invest in the Word of God. Amen? You will come out as gold.
Yeah.
Because it will change your life.
Yeah.
Look at Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4 and verses 3 and 4 it says, and the devil said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it may be made bread. And Jesus answered him, saying, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How are we supposed to live? By every word of God.
Yeah.
We got a lot of catching up to do, amen? I've been studying the Bible since I was like 6 or 7. Been preaching since I was 8. My first message, I was 8 years old, I preached on David and Goliath. And I've been studying the Word, but you know what? I am far from knowing. If I had to put a percent on what I know about the Word of God, I'd place it at probably 15%. And that's pushing it. That's probably overstating things. Because let me tell you, this is deep. This is deep. There are things in here that you will spend your lifetime searching out. But you know what? It's so sweet.
Mm-hmm.
It is so sweet. It's that honey that is sweet to your taste. Sweeter than the honeycomb. And so many things that I haven't figured out yet, but in the process of studying them, God has showed me so much other and many other things. God is so good to us.
Amen.
And in His time, He will reveal these things to us and show us. It's not that we can't understand them. It's not that we don't know them. But we need to spend the time in searching them out. Amen? Because this is His right hand, right here. His right hand is here to lift us up, to strengthen us, and to lead us, and to guide us. That's what that means, that word hand there. Let thine hand help me, for I have chosen thy precepts. That hand there means leadership. And you know what the leadership of God is? It's His Word. He has given us His written Word to lead us in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Then the last thing is He says, I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek thy servant, for I do not forget thy commandments. You know, the thing about being born again is that God has given us a new heart. And in that new heart, He writes His Word. Amen?
Amen.
And He continues to write His Word. That when we falter and go astray like a sheep, His Word is going to come up. Amen?
Amen.
Like that flag. Or like that warning sign. Whoop, stop. No, you're not. Whoop, don't do that. God's Word says this, amen? When you're a child of God, you're not going to be comfortable living in sin.
Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen. If you are comfortable living in sin, then you need to check your salvation.
Yeah.
You need to really search your salvation, because if you can live in sin and be comfortable with it, something is wrong.
Amen.
Because those who are born again, God has put His Word in their hearts. And let me tell you, even before you know it, you know something's up. Amen? I'm going to tell you, me and Brother Clifford's talking about this before. People get saved, they haven't known anything hardly about God's Word at all, but they can see things in their life that are wrong and that they need to get right, because God's put it in their heart. They are being led now by the Holy Spirit. Amen? They're going to see it in God's Word and know what's right. And when we do wrong, I'm going to tell you what, we're going to have a conscience. We're going to have the Holy Spirit weighing on our conscience with the Word of God there to judge us and to teach us of His judgments and of His righteousness.
Yeah.
If we go astray, God's not just going to say, well, I'll cut my losses. No, that's not God's love for us. If we go astray, He's not going to leave us alone. Amen.
Right. Amen.
He's not. He says, I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek thy servant. This is what the will of God for us is. Amen? If we go astray, He's going to come after us.
Mm-hmm.
He's not going to leave us alone.
No.
And He is going to convict us of sin, righteousness, and judgment until we come back to Him and restore that fellowship once again.
Right.
Look at Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8, verses 10 through 12, it says, For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For all shall know me, from the least to the greatest.
Yeah.
For I will be merciful unto their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember
Amen.
No more.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. What a precious, blessed hope that we have in Jesus Christ. That He has written His law in our hearts and put them in our minds. Isn't it wonderful when something's going on and God just pops one of His verses up into your mind?
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, man, that's awesome, isn't it? That's that personal relationship we have with the Lord. Amen?
Yeah.
And He is merciful to us. When we fail, when we do wrong, He is there. He is there to show us our wrongdoing.
Amen.
And to convict us. Don't ever get tired of conviction.
Amen.
See, that's wrong with people today. That's why the churches aren't filled. Is because people don't like conviction. They lack conviction to stand upon the Word of God.
Yeah.
And they won't go to a church where it's preached against sin, because No, that's too hard. That person's preaching hate. No. Listen, we are the ones who need saving here. Amen? We are the ones who need changing here. Not Amen. God. The problem is not with His Word. It's with us. Amen?
Yes.
We are the ones that need to change. And that's only going to come when God convicts us of our sins and we confess it Amen. And get it right. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. Verse 5 it says, Now the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and out of a good conscience and faith unfeigned. Yeah. Only God can do that. Mm. A pure heart, a good conscience, only God can do that. Amen?
Yeah.
From which some, having swerved, have turned aside unto vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm.
Mm-hmm.
I hate talking to people like that.
Me too.
It's like fingernails on a chalkboard, you know what I'm saying? It's like their mouth's moving, but nothing. Anyway, we'll go on. And it says, verse 8, But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind. Hello, homosexuality,
mm-hmm.
right here. How can a person say they're a Christian and believe in that? I have no idea. For men stealers, for liars, for perjured persons, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust.
Yeah.
And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious. You see how he owns up to his sin?
Mm-hmm.
He did not try to hide it or justify it. He owned up to it. You will not do anything for God as long as you try to hide your sin.
Yeah. Yeah.
As long as you try to justify your actions, it does no good.
No.
But when you admit it and face it and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Lord, be merciful to me.
Yeah.
Man, that's when God can work in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's what He did in Paul's life. Because Paul admitted his sin. And then what happened? But I obtain mercy.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Yeah.
When you will admit and face your sin and confess it to God, He is merciful. Amen. Because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. All sin is unbelief. Amen. All sin falls under that category of unbelief. Because whatsoever is not of faith is what?
Sin.
Sin. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So, all unbelief, all sin is unbelief. Boy, that'll make you think next time you mess up, woman. You're not walking in faith, are you? We got to walk in faith, amen? And verse 14 says, And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundantly with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief.
Mm-hmm.
Howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on Him to life everlasting. Now unto the King eternal and mortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Listen, Paul is a great example,
mm-hmm.
and God used him for an example to us. You know what? If we've made mistakes in our past, those have no bearing on our future. Because if we have trusted in Jesus Christ, as we have read, He has forgiven all of our sins. And we need to keep on fighting a good fight of faith and keep on going for the Lord. Verse 18 says, "This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare." Holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck of, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. Listen, if we're going to fight a good warfare, we're going to have to stand in the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We can't stand in the past. We can't stand in those things that we can't change. Because of, as I said, and starting at verse 5, a pure heart and a good conscience does not come from us. It cannot. Because your conscience, you know what? If you don't confess your sin to God, your conscience will never be clean. It will never be clean. And you know what? Your heart is full of dirty, nasty things, and it will never be pure until you confess it to God. And then only will He purify your heart and clean your conscience. And then you can war a good warfare in the Lord. Because why? Because He will not forsake you. Amen? He is not going to wad you up and throw you away. If you are His, you are His to the uttermost. Amen?
Amen.
He gave you everlasting life. That means that it never stops. There is no waiting. It is everlasting. And He gave you eternal. That means it's never ending. It's without interruption, never ending. You don't have to worry about it anymore. If you are saved, you are saved. Now serve the Lord.
Amen.
You mess up, confess it, and get it right. Amen? And keep on going for the Lord.
Yeah.
Because, let me tell you, His Word is in your heart. And as you continue to learn His Word, it'll continue to stay with you in your heart.
Yeah.
And you know what? That promise is even given to parents for their children. It says, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when they're old, they won't turn away from it, or they will return to it. Amen? What does that teach us? That the Word of God is going to make an impact. Amen?
Yes.
The Word of God will impact lives far greater than anything that we have at our disposal. Far greater than anything that we have in this life, the Word of God will make the impact.
Amen.
In our lives and in the lives of others, if we'll just continue in the faith.
Yeah.
That means to grow in our faith.
Yeah.
To grow in the grace. And then one last verse, and we'll be through. I know I'm long-winded, but that's all right. 1 John chapter 1. I won't be the last. I'm not the first long-winded preacher, and I probably won't be the last. 1 John chapter 1, starting in verse 6, says, "If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth." You know, darkness is ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
If we say we have fellowship with God and we walk in ignorance, we say, well, I'd rather not know. Because ignorance is bliss. You know, I can live the way I want to. And I don't have to know really what God says because we're lying. We do not have fellowship with God if we love being ignorant of God's Word.
Mm-hmm.
Just not, it's not the truth. We lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Amen.
If we walk in the light of what? The light of God, the
yes.
light of Jesus Christ, the light that has been given to us to light our way, the word of God.
Amen.
As he is in the light, amen? Do you believe God's in the light?
Amen.
Do you believe Jesus is in the light?
Yes.
I believe when I study right here, I am seeing the face of God. Amen.
Amen.
When I study his word, I see his glory. The Bible says that when we look as beholding in a glass the glory of the Lord, that we are changed into that same glory. And what is that glass? It's a mirror, as we have said over and over. As we look into the perfect law of liberty, the mirror in which God created so that we might see the image of Jesus Christ, to be changed into that same image. When we read the Word of God, he is present there.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life.
Yeah.
And when we walk in the light, he is in the light. We have fellowship one with another. You cannot have fellowship with God if you are not walking in the light
Amen.
Of his word.
Amen.
Period. You can't do it. It is impossible. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, or it says, but we will have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
Mm-hmm.
If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us.
Yeah.
My little children, these things write I unto you that ye sin not.
Mm-hmm.
And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous.
Yeah.
Amen.
Praise God for our advocate.
Yeah.
And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Yeah.
And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him.
Yeah.
But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him.
Amen.
Let's stand. Lord, we thank you tonight for your word. We just pray that you would help us to see the importance of your word, that it is your word that contains the answers. It is in your word that we have all things that pertain to life and godliness. It is in your word that we have our being, Lord, because your word is life. Lord, and it was given to us to show us the way. Lord, that we might walk in the light and have fellowship one with another. Lord, that when we call upon you, we know that you hear us. And Lord, that you have an answer for us in your word. Lord, we thank you for that personal relationship that you have with each one of us. And Lord, not with us only, but with all them that humble themselves and call upon your name. Lord, for we know that you're not a respecter of persons. Lord, we just pray that you would forgive us in those times that we fail you. Lord, help us to continue to fight the good fight of faith, to war a good warfare. Lord, we give you honor, glory, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.